you've been on set working with an amazing lineup of brilliantly talented people for Infinity Wars, and I'm curious, what's that experience been like? How did it compare with working with the rest of the Guardians game?
Well, I mean, both experiences were great individually. We've really built quite a family on the Guardians movies, and I love that cast so much. And then it was great to then work with see a lot of the old people, but also work with a new bunch of people on the Infinity War movies. I have so much respect for everyone that I worked with, and also for the people who put these casts together. I mean, it's Hollywood's kind of a strange place, and I gotta say, I've really enjoyed all of the people that I've been able to meet and learn from.
What about Joe and Anthony as directors? Obviously, a different experience from working with James, mm-hmm. I imagine.
I love Joe and Anthony. They're very different from my brother, but all directors are. And I also haven't known them since I was born, so that makes it a little different. They're great. They and I like how they work off one another, and they're pretty unflappable. And I think that that's one area where they share with my brother is that they're very calm set presences, which can be hugely important in films like these.
The latest Infinity War trailer. What do you think of
Star
Lord?
He did
Tony Stark. That was hilarious.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. I can't wait to see that on the big screen. But I have inside knowledge about a lot of that stuff. So again,
you know, friends. Come on.
Right. Of course. Yeah. 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 What I say here stays here, right, guys?
We'll all pause the dictaphone for a second. Yeah.
Which character in Infinity War has the best reaction to a talking raccoon?
Oh, gosh. I think you're going to have to be the judge of that. Although it was certainly fun to see many of these new characters through the eyes of Rocket. Because, Rocket does not have the same sort of reverence for the superheroes that the average Earthling is going to have. So I think there's a lot of fun there.
More on that point, is there a scene where Rocket encounters a wild raccoon and sort of gets the revelation of, introspectively, who he is? Anything like that?
I can't comment on any scenes.
I think the real question is, who's taller, Rocket or Iron Man?
Who wears the biggest Cuban heels?
I was doing double duty, triple duty, if you consider both roles in Guardians, and then also doing Gilmore Girls at the same time. So we were shooting Guardians 2 simultaneously. I was flying back and forth between Georgia and California to do those roles. But the good thing about going back and doing Gilmore Girls again is that it was kind of like putting on a comfortable old pair of slippers. It didn't take long to get back into that character. Kirk is very, very familiar and available to me. When the writing is as good as it is, it makes it that much easier.
What's it like in the Rocket Raccoon suit?
Well, now, most of the stills that people see are from the first movie when I was wearing the green leotard. But in the subsequent films, I just wear a gray tracksuit, which is a lot more comfortable and less dorky looking than the leotard. So that's a little bit better. But yeah, no, I'm four movies now into doing Rocket on set, and I think sometimes I forget when actors show up for the first time who've never actually seen me do it, they get a little freaked out by whoa, that guy's really just getting down and walking on his, in a crouch position.
Is it method acting then, would you call it?
I don't root around and eat trash like raccoons do. I did have to dig on some of my drama school training of being an animal, getting down and being an animal.
previously worked with Michael Rooker on Super, another one of James Bond's movies.
Yeah.
Was it interesting to get back in when he was doing Yondu and Kraglin with Guardians of the Galaxy?
Oh, God, I just want to do one movie without Rooker.
Is that why you separated the panel now?
Yeah, right, right. I love Rooker. He's like a crazy uncle. And I knew him. We were friends before we even did Super. So, I've done now. I guess we've done four movies together. So, yeah.
What about Kraken? How's the whistling coming along?
Gosh, I hope it's coming along well. We need Kraglin to learn how to use that whistle, don't we?
We do.
I need, if I'm going to have any sort of an imprint on the third movie, I think he better learn.
And obviously, we're going to hopefully have Kraglin back in a big capacity in the third movie. But I think it was interesting. Fans noticed that you're not listed as Kraglin on the cast list, on at least IMDb, for Infinity Wars. So is Kraglin not going to be a part of that, or are we going to see you in that capacity there?
I think I can't really answer. You won't see Kraglin in the first Infinity War movie, and then after you all see it, we can talk further after that. Because a lot of things happen in that movie that bear on subsequent movies. So,
I think obviously, in the last film, it was really nice to see Kraglin go from just a supporting character to really a full-fledged guardian. Is that something you're excited about with the third film? Has James sort of told you that's something that he's excited about?
Yeah, we've talked a little bit about, he tells me some, he gives me some hints here and there about what the plot will be like for the third movie. I haven't seen any words or seen any script, but he sort of will sit me down and say, it's kind of going this direction, and he's such a diligent planner that usually the way he says things are going to work out, they usually are pretty close to going that direction. So I don't know. I never get my hopes up. It's Hollywood. You're really not in the movie until the movie's finished. Which is a long ways from now, and I care more about the story than about the characters. So I just want the movie to be great. But anything that they ask me to do, I'll be ready to do for sure. James doesn't let anyone choose any songs on the soundtrack. I think he takes. You know, it's funny. He uses a lot of songs that I've loved my whole life, as well as him. My brothers and I are really, really into music, and. And I'm never surprised by his selections. He's never used a song that I don't know. But I also think he takes a lot of pride in being able to say that he personally handpicks all the songs with no help from anyone. So I'll let him have that.
What sort of songs would you put on a soundtrack for a third film then, if you were allowed one or two song choices?
Oh, man. What I like about the third movie is that, this is speculation. I don't know this from James, but it seems to be set up that the soundtrack would come from Yondu Zune in the third movie. I mean, that might be a guess, but so it'd be interesting to see what Yondu listens to. I'd love to hear something like Jukebox Hero, I think would be fun. Now that I said that, it won't be in the movie. Because
I mean, talking about things that aren't in the movie, the outtakes from Guardians are hilarious in their own right. Do you have a favorite? Is there anything that didn't make it onto film but was hilarious on set at the time that you wish people could see?
Well, I like that outtake that's from the second movie at the end when I'm going over the bands when Star-Lord and Kraglin are talking about the bands on the Zune and Kraglin mentions Thin Lizzy and that chick Alice Cooper and that's certainly a lot of fun. You know, we're pretty lucky though. I mean, there's been very little that's been cut from the movie. I think I had one scene as Rocket from the first movie, and then some little bits and pieces of stuff with Kraglin from both movies. But for the most part, what we shoot goes in the film. You know, we don't improv that much. I would say that most of the dialogue is performed as written in the script. Things that are improvised are more likely to be buttons at the end of scenes. So like just a joke line that it goes out on and something like you have a little more room to play there. The bulk of the improvising is done by my brother from behind the camera. So I know that he has his script that he works with that we've seen. And then he also has his alternate line script that he has for every day, which are things that he's he's feeding us as we're acting. He'll say, do it again now with this line, now with this line. But just like everything, even though they feel like ad-libs to us because we haven't heard them, he's super prepared and usually has a list of them ready to go. Not a whole lot is actually thought up right there on the spot. There are a few lines here and there, but most of it's scripted.
Yeah, what about Chris Pratt? Does he come up with a few one-liners he shouldn't do?
Yeah, you know, they definitely have fun, and I know that, my brother will say to Chris at certain moments, here's an opportunity if you want to ad-lib something or throw something in, you can do it there, and they talk about it. But it's never pandemonium, you know? It's never like everybody's saying whatever the hell they think is funny at the moment. It's we stick to the script for the most part and have fun, but it's controlled fun.
Everyone absolutely adored Baby Groot, and we're so glad we got a whole film with him. Mm-hmm. What can we expect from Teenage Groot?
Gosh, I don't know. Well, you saw a little bit of Teenage Groot with his in the tag scene for the second movie. So you don't have too long to wait now. So I need to keep my mouth shut so I don't say anything I shouldn't. I mean, Groot certainly ages more quickly than a human does, because Baby Groot in the second movie is about 3 months old. You know, he's still... which is very young, but still enough to kind of like walk around and speak. So I think that whatever time may have passed between the second Guardians and the first Infinity War has probably aged him a little bit more.
James recently, I think, upset a lot of people when he confirmed the fact that the Groot that we see in Guardians Volume 2 is not the Groot that we've known and loved from the first film, but is his son, in fact, and that the group in the first film is officially dead, and I think that sort of changed people's perspective on the end of the first film. How did you feel about that?
Well, it certainly doesn't change my perspective of the end of the first film, because I think that regardless of the mechanics of it or the biomechanics of it, you know, the idea of Rocket preserving that piece from his friend packs some emotional weight, regardless of what exactly it is that we're looking at. I don't think that changes how special that moment is, and it certainly doesn't take away from the sacrifice. If anything, it enhances the sacrifice that Groot makes in the first movie. But you know, I don't know. I didn't know much about Groot procreation myself, so I'm learning just like you guys
We're
are.
Learning as James teaches us.
Yeah,
does that
right.
mean Rocket is officially Groot's mother now?
Well,
like a seals.
You know, he's certainly his adopted guardian. I would say that. One of the reasons that I think my brother and I work so well together is that yes, we've worked together since we were kids in different capacities. So our shorthand for communicating with one another is very clean and very very easy. But also, I think we're both perfectionists within our own jobs. And he's very much, he's a very good director and a very clear director. And I take my job as an actor very, very seriously. And so I think that even if we were just meeting for the first time, I still think he and I would work together really, really well, because he's good at talking to actors, and I would like to think that I'm good at listening to directors. So it really is. I mean, you know, I think that the advantage is that any time it's in any period of time where I need to figure out how to work with somebody to have a creative relationship, that part of the job is already done. We already have a creative relationship when we walk in the door.
So you definitely don't have a Sam and Ted Raimi relationship then with your brother.
Right. Yeah. But, you know, and then the negative things, he doesn't, you know, we're not very competitive in my family, and he's the older brother and I'm the younger brother, so I think that's good. And I love working with my brother. I hope that we continue to work together here and there for the rest of our careers. I would think that we would. I don't need to do everything he's in, and you know, he's producing something right now I'm not going to do. So it's like I don't need to, like, we can go off and do our separate things, but yeah, I'll always say yes, obviously.
the original Guardians of the Galaxy reunited at the end of Guardians of the Galaxy 2 from the comic book series.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like Kraglin to be in a spin-off with the rest of them?
I would love to work with those guys, I can tell you that. But I try not to... I try not to prognosticate about what's going to go, about what's going to happen, because you're only setting yourself up for disappointment if you try to worry about where you want the story to go. You got to let it just kind of go where it goes. I mean, I already worked with the Hoff on the on the Guardians Inferno video. I don't know how it gets better than that. Gosh, I got to say, with everybody that I've worked with on these movies, not just Guardians, but now Infinity War, my cup runneth over with big, famous, iconic actors. So I'm happy with anybody, truly.
The Inferno video was one of the most glorious things we've ever seen.
Oh.
Can you talk about the experience of filming that and, of course, working with Zardu Hasselfra himself?
Yeah, right. That was really fun, that Guardians video. It was something that I think they threw together pretty quickly. But they saw the link for the original, for the weird Star Wars dance video that it was kind of based on. This is something we got together in a day and had an absolute blast.
Did you get to choose which moustache to wear?
They had some ideas. We worked on it a little bit together, but I certainly was very, very pleased with how that worked out. I got to play that character in a movie the whole time, I think.
What was David Hasselhoff like? I mean, obviously, lovely to see him pop up in the film as well.
Oh, he's a lovely man. I just saw him at the Black Panther premiere, and it was good to catch up. He's such a gregarious, big personality, very warm dude. You know, people talk a lot about the fanboys and fangirls from the MCU and how rabid they are, but I assure you that Gilmore Girls fans give them a run for their money every step of the way in their fervor for what they love. I'm very grateful to be part of both those of both those franchises, and I think it starts with really great writing and great stories, and I've been very lucky to be part of those.
Yeah,